Hallelujah. Well, it's good to be back in the best church on the planet. With all you guys. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. How we worship you, our Father. We worship you, Lord Jesus. We worship you, Holy Spirit. We worship you, Lord Jesus. Be exalted, be revealed in our lives, Lord Jesus. Be exalted, be revealed in our lives, Lord. We yield ourselves to you. Under kaseya benin the baya. Isara mungare ni ish ni kere ni naya. At romonde de denga le manda de besa te loya romo. Zibebekine mendea sikana. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, you can be seated. I know you guys have been worshiping about 2 hours or so. I've been traveling since 9 o'clock this morning. Thank you, Father, for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father, for the wonderful works of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for the glorious presence of the Holy Ghost in our life, in us and with us. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you, Father, that you gave us more than an angel. You gave us more than a hedge. You gave us the Holy Ghost. Father, you gave us your very best. You gave us Jesus, hidden in the bosom, hidden in your bosom, hid away in you, who is willing to become everything that we are, that we might be made everything that he is. Lord, we thank you that you gave us the treasure of the Holy Ghost. Father, we pray in Jesus' name, every one of us will begin to take the treasure of your heart, the treasures of your heart, and make them the treasures of our life. Oh, come on, Deo, si taio no mumbedesia. Harabada da da vesi ki di andulo pahalo si viti lia. Branda da da vaketi shipea. Hakana men bende via tisht. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mighty God. I want you to open your Bibles with me to Acts chapter 17, verse 31. Manganda de debexti tiapa. Acts 17, verse 31 has a great relationship to Acts 16, verse 31. But I want to start with you, just look at with me here in Acts 17, verse 31. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I usually never want to quit worshiping either. It's just temple. Hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus. You know, the Holy Spirit is here to take us and transition our whole consciousness, our way of thinking, over into a heavenly realm, over into a disposition and consciousness. and thought of ourselves and perception of the world around us, all within the perspective of who Jesus is. Just think about that. God the Holy Ghost is here to take us and move us out of the realm of all of our human limitations, our discouragements, our disappointments, our fears, our issues, just the realms of humanity, and move us over into the realms of everything that He is. He's called us. This is His idea. He says, come, I want you to come, and as a branch, I want you to come here and dwell in the vine. And the Holy Spirit will be the sap. And what's going to happen is the fruits of my life are going to be produced in you. So that what you look like is, are those verses of Scripture that I no longer live, it's Christ Jesus that lives. What you and I look like are those who are partakers of the divine nature. What you and I look like are those who have been clothed with, put on, endued with the very person of Christ. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. To put Him on is to be endued. That's the Greek word. It's enduo. It's the same word as you will be endued with power from on high. So the Lord says, what my purpose and my plan for you is that you walk around in the same glory that I have, and you and I have all of these distractions, and we have all these things going on because we live in a world that demands of us things that are absolutely opposite of what Father commands us to be and have. So Father has commanded in our life perfect obedience. God commands perfect. He commands us to be perfect. And this comes as a great shock to a modern church. It doesn't come as a great shock to Jenny Wilkerson, to Wigglesworth, to John G. Lake, to A.B. Simpson. And I could keep marching on back in the history of the church. It's not, they talked about it. They preached it. And the beautiful thing of it is He doesn't demand of us perfect obedience outside of the context of empowering us. See, the Lord wants us to live the kind of life we would like to die and go to. And we don't really even understand that. It's a shock. It's shocking. It just goes over everybody's head. They're like, what? You know, I was planning on a career as a scientist, as a, you know, as a whatever. A doctor, a lawyer, a, I don't know. Whatever it was that you, some professional something or other. Surfer, snowboarder, extreme sports. Whatever. And Father's planned this life, this heavenly life for us, where we can walk around in divine power and glory. He's planned a life for us to where that we're conformed in every way to the image of Christ Jesus. And we just haven't thought about it enough. And we just haven't investigated enough. We start to think about it and the roadblock comes up. No, you got to go to work. We start thinking about it a little bit more. Oh, you got to take care of yourself. You start thinking about it a little bit deeper. Oh, you start considering what you're going to wear, what you're going to eat. But the Lord said, listen, I really don't want you. He said, I don't want you, in Matthew chapter 6, to consider what you're going to eat or what you're going to wear. He's telling us right there with a big, gigantic exclamation mark, there's a realm of divine provision for you. But it's a realm of divine provision that comes as the result of you and I stepping over into the realms of the kingdom. Now, what's going to happen in the not-too-distant future is people are going to be desperate more for the realms of the kingdom and to live in the realms of the kingdom and to benefit from the realms of the kingdom, because the bottom is going to fall out of what you've been living in. What we've been living in, I tell you right now, I'm getting ready to publish a new book. It's called The Final Kingdoms on the Earth. It will help you understand that the bottom is getting ready to fall out. And I know this, not because some spincaster said so, not because some economist says so, because I know what the Bible says, I know where it's going, and I know, based on what the Word of God reveals, the series of events that have got to take place in order to bring us to that. And it's good, and the world is much, much different than what it is now. But I'm just trying to give you some kind of, onus, impetus to say, wait a minute, why don't I go ahead and just learn how to investigate a little bit deeper this life that God is calling me into, instead of living after the template that has been set before me in a world that was designed by the satanic realm. God says that the whole world lies in the satanic occult. The whole world lies in wickedness. The whole world lies in that which is designed by devils and demons. See, when God didn't put any restraint on the devils and demons, or basically put some limit of restraint, but It was a whole lot less restraint than it is now. In 1965 years, Satan had so ruined man that there was no more image left of him at all. He was so removed from any likeness of God. First and foremost, there was no way back to God. And second, Father said, it even repents me, it grieves me in my heart that I ever made such a creature. Then Father destroys the earth with the flood of Noah. And then we can see obviously that he did put more satanic restraint. He put more restraints on the satanic realm to where that things couldn't go the way they went before. He put restraints on the age of men, how old they could live to be, to propagate their wickedness. And then ultimately we find ourselves where we are at today to ultimately come to a place in the future again where all restraints are completely removed. All restraints are completely removed in the tribulation. All restraints that are on Satan are completely removed from off of him. He's cast out of the realms of the heavenlies, out of the unseen realm, and he's cast into the seen realm. And that's where the great devastation that people really haven't fully contemplated even that. It's just like, you know, there are so many measurable things. You've got all these mathematicians and all these scientists, and they put all this time into the pursuit of how to make a better weapon to blow people up. They put all this pursuit into how to make a better satellite to make more money and all the other things. And what would happen if they would have been hovering over the Word of God more than me and investigating the things of heaven and really paring out for everybody to see the magnitude of what is described for us in the book of Daniel and Revelation, for example. We're too preoccupied with other things that have no meaning, they have no value. It's going to perish with the using. One day God's going to take the heavens and the earth and he's going to fold them up as a man folds up a garment. And they shall be no more. They shall wax old as a garment, and he will fold them up and basically throw them away. They shall be no more. Father did something for us that very few people in history have even contemplated the depth of it, and even fewer have stepped into it. I personally believe that when you begin to contemplate the depth of what God has given to us in the so great of salvation, this life of oneness with him, not a transcendent otherness, but a life of oneness where we can live out our life in the holies of holies, where this isn't figurative, it's not a simile, it's not positional, but it's a living reality, and we have been barred out against it because of ideology and philosophy and religious precepts and concepts and people who basically get some place in God and then they just almost, as it were, hold everybody in that limit. And I tell you, if we would start contemplating what Father has for us, he is so eager to bring it to pass within our life. When you just think about the fact that Jesus said, if you love me and you obey me, my Father will love you, and we will come and make our dwelling inside of you. Just consider the reality for just a moment, the magnitude of that reality being expressed within our lives, dear people. I'm talking to some folks here that you've been seated enough with the Word of God, you've been seated enough with the presence of God, that all you have to do is make one small little adjustment in your life to say, now I'm going to go after this like never before. I'm going to understand how to cooperate with the Lord. I'm going to learn how to set myself apart. My wife's reading a book for the second time. It's a great book. Jenny Wilkerson did it. It's called Contact with God. And we look back, and if we'll skip over a bunch of nonsense, we can go back to different people who laid hold on God. We go back to another woman, Mariah Woodworth Etter, who laid hold on God. Mariah Woodworth Etter, I'm going to tell you right now, you listen to me, she would have not tolerated, I don't even know if she would have been even possible for her to be invited to any church anywhere. If you read her writings and the holiness that she lived in, and the sacredness that she lived in. I mean, I'm telling you right now, people, we look at that and we call it legalism. No, that wasn't legalism. She was living by the Holy Ghost. Legalism, arrogant legalism, is where you believe you can live your life without the Holy Ghost, where you can live in and out of the Holy Ghost, you see. And Father wants to draw us into a deeper realm of glory. I mean, you know, it's a wonderful thing. She's called Mother of Pentecost because of the great display of the power of Pentecost through her life, the great signs and wonders and miracles. We haven't seen in our modern time the miracles that these common, ordinary people had in their life back in as late as 1930 and 1940. But especially back at the turn of the century, when the fresh wave of the Holy Ghost began to pour over people that had been eagerly hungering and thirsting. See, you're not hungry for anything that you can live without. See, the very fact that you're hungry for food is because you've got to have it, otherwise you're going to die. So you're not hungry for anything that you can live without. In the holiness revival of 1870 and 1880, in 1890, what we had was we had people writing songs like "Take My Will and Make It Thine, It Shall Be No Longer Mine." "Take My Heart, It Is Your Throne, It Shall Be Your Royal." It is your own, it shall be your royal throne. I mean, that, you know, that we had people, you know, writing things that you could read about right now in A.B. Simpson's writings and others. And you see, when you go back there into that apostolic holiness movement, what you find is you find this great, deep, passionate hunger. Oh, God, we'll do anything, whatever it takes. We just got to have you. We're desperate for you. And then so in that climate and in that environment, when the Holy Ghost began to sovereignly move, when Father began to do things sovereignly, I want you to understand something. Just take a side note. Everything is all about the Father. You believe me. When you ask Jesus, he'll say it's all about the Father. Ask the Holy Ghost, he'll say it's all about the Father. I'm going to tell you right now, these are some things that we haven't contemplated. We don't really understand. But if we'll begin to set aside our life and set aside our ambitions and set aside our motives, and we begin to say, wait a minute, I'm going to contemplate what God says in his word, that it's a reality and that I don't have to wonder about it anymore. He's inviting me to come in. And if we could just do this, if we could just throw everything on hold and begin to get passionate about God, because it's free, but he wants us to be desperate for it, otherwise it'll ruin us. See, it might be given to all men and poured out upon all flesh, but it's still so holy, holy, holy to God. It's still so sacred to God. And there's got to be an interaction with him where these things become so sacred to us, so precious to us. I mean, I don't even know the adjectives to describe how sacred these things are that people are rolling around and jumping over and stomping on, and you know what I'm saying, and treating as though it was common. It's not common. It's not ordinary. And so they were there, desperate, passionate. And, you know, just spend some years reading. Or you could start out and spend some months reading. All these things that are being written, especially in the 1800s. God had found a people in the 1800s. You could see it within the Presbyterian movement, within the Methodist movement. Cambridge Revival, it's Presbyterians. You could see this desperate hunger. It was the Presbyterians that built Harvard and built Princeton, and you know, and I mean, back in those days, Scripture was everywhere, and those would be the liberal folks, and the real hungry conservative folks. They were crawled up in some hollow log somewhere, crying out to God, fasting and praying. They got to know Him. They got to know the God of the Bible. And today, modern people look back on that and they point a finger and they laugh and they sneer, and boy, hasn't God brought us far. No, I don't see God brought us far towards in respect to proximity to Him. I see that man has brought us far away from Him. And in the midst of that, but I want you to think about it, there's always these sovereign moves of God because of God's goodness. He's always pouring out His rain upon the just and the unjust. He's always causing His sun to shine on the righteous and the wicked, both in the natural and also in the spiritual. There's these seasons in God. There's no question about it. It's first and foremost established in the Word. Secondly, it's seen in historical events. That's why Evan Roberts was able to say, in Wells, every 35 to 40 years, there was a great move of God. And there's volumes of books written on it. Also in Scotland as well, starting back as early as the late 1600s. And so that was just the order and the conversation of the day, and it had built to the 1800s. And so when Evan Roberts is a young man at the age of about 12 years old, You know, he's already been in church long enough to hear about the last great move of God and the great move of God before that. And he says, well, what will it take for me to be in a great move of God like that as well? He's already hungry. He's hungry. He's seated. He's hearing about what it was like when the Spirit of God began to move upon the earth, began to move through wells. He heard the things, the reports, the great signs and wonders, the miracles, the great Holy Ghost conviction that would fall upon people. He wanted to have that. He wanted to have that interaction with Father that was nothing, had nothing to do with any earthly or normal thing that could be described to him or he could handle at that moment. And that's kind of the revivalist fire, if you would. And of course, as Pastor just said, you need to be in all the meetings. You need just to hunger for God. You need to build an altar. And he started with a prayer. Lord, I've built the altar. I've laid the wood in order according to your word. Sacrifice is ready. Send the fire now. See, what people mess up on is I understand the various different applications that folks use, biblical applications where they use them, but it's not perfectly appropriate. Because God never sent us fire till the sacrifice was absolutely perfect. Never. Just go read it. Start back at Genesis. It had to be exactly like he wanted. It had to be tamim, which is a Hebrew word for perfect. It had to be without blemish. It had to meet specific specifications. And if it didn't, no fire. Starts with Cain. Sacrifice isn't perfect. There's not going to be any fire on it. It's not what I asked for. And that's always the means by which God sends his fire. And of course, back in those days, they understood it. I come to learn to understand it more by way of reading all those things of church history. And of course, hovering over top of the word of the Lord as well. But what I'm saying is there's an environment now that when God does move, whoo, now it takes everybody to another level. Why? Because the soil is ripe, the heart's ripe, the purpose is right, the passion is right. Now the sacred is poured out on that which is so desperate for the sacred that it now has the ability to take the receiver, the recipient of it, to that next place and that next dimension. Thus, we see what happened with John G. Lake, as you know, he was able to walk in the boldness of faith and do the things that God gave him to do in South Africa. So many stories associated with it. We're able to see what the Ritchie brothers did. We're able to see and understand what went on with F.F. Bosworth, especially Moriah Woodworth Eder, because everybody said no one did the miracles that she did. And she had to go through, in that midst of that environment, she had to go through more persecution than anybody else, which usually gonna make you that much more prepared to go all the way with God. Because they didn't believe in women preachers. People don't believe in women preachers now, man. Back then, you were just like, you know, you were really in trouble. And, you know, I talked to different ministers, you know, since I was a young guy. And, you know, asking even to recent times, what is it going to take for the church to begin to look like what the church is described to be in the person of Jesus? What it's described to be when Paul said it's the fullness of him that filleth all things. What is it going to take? And everybody pretty much unanimously said, people are going to have to die. You're going to have Ananias and Sapphira, because it's all the sacredness is taken away. All the government is taken away. All the authority is taken away. People trample all over the anointing and wonder why God don't move. Everybody, each to his own man. Every man rose up and went to his own tent. That describes the rebellion of Israel against the leadership of the Father. But I believe with all of my heart that it doesn't take a lot of people to get this thing going. I believe that it only takes a few. I mean, the Lord Jesus started with 12. He got to say he got kicked off with 12. He pulled in 70 others later. And by and large, the church ran 120 strong for a number of years. You know what I'm saying? It was 120 that stepped in. You know, you got 70 plus 12. You know, you're looking at 82 right there. But you've also got Mom and Aunt Salome and others around there and the cousins, you know, that aren't even counted in the 70. You already got 120, basically, that was moving as a cloud following Jesus around. Big old dust storm, basically. Okay? They parted ways. Every once in a while, I'll go home, take care of things. But by and large, by the time you get to Pentecost, there's 120 people there. Of course, we know 3,000 people got saved that first day, I'm sure Stephen was in that. Hallelujah. You know, others there visiting. Presukota Maya Sheila. But they had an environment. They had a place of understanding, having been lit, having been grown up and raised in the sacredness of the holy things of God. It was an entirely different realm. And then Jesus comes, steps in the midst of that, and God, by the Holy Ghost, breathes on it and takes it to the supernatural revelation of all that Jesus said and did. Now it's at a total another level. Now the Pentecostal fire comes on these people who live clean and holy and pure lives. They don't even eat wrong food. I mean, the way they dress, the way they wear their clothes, everything was ordered by God's word. And it took them 9 years to find out, really, it was right at 9 to 10 years to find out that they didn't have to observe kosher anymore and proper clothing anymore, but they lived their whole lives. It was dictated by the Word of God. We so far from that, and we act like we got some special insight to God. Meanwhile, there's not the fruit of it. You know, I have suffered great persecution because I won't allow rebellion. I won't allow it. People call me all kinds of names. I won't allow rebellion. I'll love people. I'll be merciful to people. I mean, I'll tell you right now, it doesn't matter whether it doesn't matter how messed up a person is. All they got to do is not be rebellious and defiant. That's it. But I mean, God, the Father, is one. He hates arrogance and rebellion. He puts those up as bigger than anything else. And reality of it is, it's messing up the whole thing. Satan is a master at his craft of being able to divide people up so that there is not the connectivity of a body, so that the person of Jesus can't be seen. And the only way that that is ever going to stop is where the individuals begin to seek God in such a way that all that matters to each person isn't all these other things that Satan can get in the big midst of and turn each person against the other and have problems and disappointments and all the other stuff that goes on in the emotions that actually has no right to be in a Holy Ghost filled person. It's actually the influence of demon power, and people still don't get it. They just think it's their thought. It's a natural consequence of their circumstance. And so they meditate on things that are actually anti-God and anti-Christ. They meditate on things, if it's not worldly, anti-God, anti-Christ, it's earthly. And earthly is going to bring you into the realms of the human. And being in the realms of the human realm, you're never going to move with God, because that's the realm of self. That's what the Lord said we must deny every day, take up our cross and follow Him. And He's describing to us what it means to live our life to do the will of the Father. That's what the cross means. It means I don't do my own will. I'm not living my own life. I'm living to do the will of my Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I know, listen, see, the beautiful thing of it is there's an anointing and there's a mantle on this place where that this word can go out. I mean, you've been prepared into such a place that you can receive these things, but you're going to have to understand that you've got to begin to do things different in your life. You still set things before you and you value them, and they're nothing more than shadows and myths. They're nothing more than phantoms. They're nothing more than illusions. They're nothing more than that which at best which moth can and rust can corrupt and destroy, which has no lasting value. And what's going to happen is you've so been taught in it, you're going to run the risk tomorrow to wake up and be all upset all day again. You're going to go from upset to happy to back to upset and concerned and worried and back to upset and then back to over something else. Happy for a minute or two and then back to upset and worried and concerned and fearful and not sure and not certain and wondering. And at best, that's earthly. That's the realm of self dominating your life. It's never going to bring you and draw you in to that which God the Holy Ghost is desperate to do, to show us that we've been made one with Him, to show us that He's made His abode in us, that He wants to live in us. He's not going to force it on us. It's something that we've got to be willing to learn by yielding ourselves to this, because we want it. We want that which He's supplied more than anything else. We want His way more than anything else. And He's not going to show you some unique new thing. He's laid it out in His Word, and He's given us quantitative, measurable things to look at, like love and joy and peace and long-suffering and gentleness and kindness and meekness and goodness. I mean, if you're not living a goodness life, it's because you're living a self life at best, or you're under the influence of demon spirits at worst. And usually those kind of migrate back and forth between each other all day long. To where you say, no, I'm yours. I'm your vessel, Father. I just want to walk in your goodness. I just want to walk in your peace. Somebody tells me, I just want to walk in your peace. Or does it come for me to pray for them? I just want peace. And my first reaction is to say, no, you don't. I mean, I was with Pat, and I was like, goodness, Pat, it's amazing how he walks up to people and just tells them like it is. You got rebellion written across the top of your head, and offense from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, and everywhere you go, you create problems. Would you like to be delivered tonight? I'm like, whoa, come on. There's somebody else bringing it to the level of reality, you know? That's an evangelist. From a pastoral point of view, there's many times I just want to say, no, you don't. What you want is more money. You want more free time, longer vacations. That's what you want. A nicer house. You want everything paid off. That's what you want. Peace is down the list. Ruh-roh. But I don't say that. I just go ahead and I minister right whatever little bit I got, you know. Father has made us the light of the world, but most of us are flickering birthday candles. You know, so we sang it too long. We prophesied over ourselves, this little light of mine, you know. And Father didn't say that at all. He said that we were supposed to rise and shine like the sun at noonday. He didn't call us a light of the world. You know what? He didn't call us a light of the world. He called us the light of the world. Jesus, help us. Here in Acts chapter 17, verse 31, and I'll just go ahead and start at verse 30. He says, Paul saying, and at the times of this ignorance, God winked at it, but now commands all men everywhere to repent. And what is he calling us to repent of? He's calling us to repent of the life that we've been living. See, we don't understand that salvation is a moment in time for people who want to be delivered from the power of darkness to come rushing to the kingdom, to come rushing, crying out, save me, help, oh God, I'm coming, and keep the door open, because we want to escape the corruption that is in the world through lust. We don't understand that. If you go back to Acts chapter 16, you look at the jailer, and he's standing there because Paul and Silas are in there singing and worshiping God, an earthquake comes because Father come to deliver them, right? And so the earthquake, their chains fall off, the earthquake happens, the jail door opens up. The jailer comes and he thinks that everybody has now escaped, and so he goes to kill himself because the torture that he's going to have to go through for letting those prisoners escape, it would be better to end his life now. And Paul screams out, touch not, don't you do yourself any harm, we all hear. And now what he is at the, he's now encountered what? He encountered God. He encountered the power of God. And the contrast is a dark, damp, snake-filled cave to this glorious light shining on paradise. From a death to a life. And he's screaming, what must I do to be saved? See, it's a different context. We just want to say, repeat after me. We got, there's the Roman Catholic genuflex. There's the Pentecostal genuflex. You know, there's a, you know, denominational genuflex. Repeat after me. That was never in the church. It was never in the church. It wasn't until Billy Sunday, who was a famous baseball player, starts becoming an evangelist minister, that he's going to do mass confirmation and say, everybody just repeat after me, now you all saved. It never existed in the church before that. It's brand new. People say it's good. I don't think it was good. I think the fruit that the church was producing before that was good. There was a clean, distinctive separation between who was born again and who was not born again. And you didn't receive communion, and you didn't receive membership in the church, and you didn't receive baptism. And somebody said, isn't that legal? No, it helps people understand where they're at with God. It helps them to understand, have you brought forth fruit that declares your repentance? Is there been a change? And if there hasn't been a change, we're not going to kick you out. We're going to deal with you until a change comes. And, you know, some of my friends took this thing up, like Carlos, and said, look, we can't just do mass conversions. We need to take these people in, and we need to talk to them and set them down and see where they're at, and to take them through forgiveness and let them know they can't be doing that thing anymore and this thing over here anymore. They've got to realize that this is a sacred realm, that there's a transformation, and we got to get them delivered from the strongholds of the enemy that are placed upon them, because that's our job. So I say, you don't need to do that. Holy Ghost could do that. Nonsense. God said it's our job to teach them to observe all things. I mean, look at Philip. He's with the eunuch. The eunuch is desperate. Philip said, examines him. He gives him an examination. The eunuch says, what hinders me from being baptized? Because we know that water baptism is absolutely an essential part of salvation. Somebody said, how about the thief on the cross? We ain't talking about the thief on the cross. There's one of them at one point in time. That's it. The rest of us need to do what God said to do. Are you listening to me? Because we see it with you. We see it with Philip. We know what Philip's doing. He's doing more than helping him understand Isaiah chapter 53. Because the eunuch says, what hinders me from being baptized? Philip gives him an examination. Nothing so long as you believe with all of your heart. He examines him. Are you real about this? Is this a death, burial, and resurrection? A new life? Are you willing to step into the heavenly life? Are you willing to step into the life of the Holy Ghost? Do you realize who Jesus is? Do you realize he's Almighty God who's come to deliver us? He's come to rescue us from the darkness, from the prison of sin, so that we will no longer live therein. We compromise, at best neutralized, in most places assimilated into the world system, into a demonic stronghold. And that's why we see the results that we have in the United States of America. That's because when the church is doing what the church is supposed to be doing, we are the hinderer of iniquity. We decide. We don't understand it because we don't have a vote system. It's all spiritual. We decide what the state, the spiritual state and atmosphere of a nation is going to be. That's how we can make disciples out of nations. Because when we walk with God, Holy Ghost conviction hovers over the place, and blessing also. I mean, when Guadalajara? Some of those places in Guadalajara during the revival in the 90s. They so stepped into a flow of the Spirit. I mean, all their fruit was like three times the size. Was that Guadalajara? Does anybody else know? I can't remember what. I'm pretty sure it was Guadalajara. And I mean, it just isn't the way it is. When the church is who the church is supposed to be, when we're walking with God the Holy Ghost the way we're supposed to, there's blessings in every area. Our life, our body, our spirit, our ground, everything that we have is blessed. We're blessed in the field, we're blessed in the house, we're blessed in the city, we're blessed in, come on, you know, we're blessed coming in, we're blessed going out. You just walk in and out of your house and get blessed. I'm going to get blessed again, I'm going to go back out so I get blessed again. And here's what the Lord says. Because he's appointed him, verse 31. See, there's a separation going on. God's made a way for people who want out of the demonic realm, out of the sin realm, out of the iniquity realm, out of the demon power realm. He's made a way for us to come out. But we're all choosing what we want. And that's why he said he's commanded everybody else, everybody everywhere to repent, to have this change of life. It is the greatest power of deliverance. Repentance literally is the event. The primary focus of repentance is the event of change, the new birth, the change. That's what repentance means, change. Is there a place of receiving forgiveness of sin and repentance after you have been born again? Well, there was a provision. If that happens, not when that happens, it was like, if that does happen, But we live in the when it happens. And we live in it. We've normalized it. It's not normalized in Scripture. If that happens, we have an advocate with Father. Praise God. We are, you know, I think about Lot, and I think about how he was vexed with a filthy conversation of the wicked. The Scripture says he vexed his righteous soul. But look what happened because he allowed himself to be bathed in the iniquity that was going on around him. Look at all the wrong choices that he was going to make. Look at ultimately where it led him. It led him to destruction. That's what's going to happen. People live under the grace and they live under the mercy of God. They live under God's goodness that continues to pour out his blessing, where you feel his presence and you feel his peace and you feel his anointing. All him saying, I'm here to give you the power. I'm here to give you the ability. I'm here to stand with you with my loving kindness and my tender mercies. And we take it as full-blown approval, certified approval. And all Father's doing is saying, no, I'm calling you to do what my word says for you to do. I'm calling you to come in over here and live this life that I have so went to such great expense to pay for you to have. And there's not a lot, it just, when you look at the landscape of things, there's not a lot of response. So let's, you know, there's therefore a gigantic difference when God pours out the anointing of the Holy Ghost upon people who've been hungering and thirsting after righteousness, hungry for the kingdom, who understand sacredness, who understand that everything about God's stuff is sacred. Now, back then, they would call a person like me reverend. And it's not that I would ever want to be called reverend necessarily, but the bigger point is the sacredness of it, the honor that was there. Even a rank sinner would call a person reverend. Now, it's like, it's just totally, it's... The holy has been made common. The sacred has been made unclean. It's been made profane. For one of the things that Father is over and again talking about in the Scriptures, that there's never been a division between the sacred, a distinction between that which is holy and that which is profane, that which is acceptable to me, that which is clean and that which is unclean. We have to do that with our personal lives. You know, and... You know, that's why I began to talk to you about when I was last with you last Sunday night. I began to talk to you about the Scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. To make sure that you understand that you're not allowing yourself to be in an environment where this flow of iniquity is coming at you. Because you're righteous, not unrighteous. You're of light, not of darkness. You're of Christ, not of Belial or of the demon power or demon spirits. You're not of the covetous realm of idols. You are a temple of the living God, and God lives in you and walks in you. And having these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from the filthiness of the body and of the spirit. Because God said already, just our previous said, you're supposed to glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are his. But if you continue to allow yourself to be in that environment, God says you need to be separate from that environment. That's what I already said right there in the previous verse. Come out from among them, touch not the unclean thing, be separate. And so what he's saying, once again, he's saying, look, having these promises of Father living in us and walking in us and being our God, him being and us being his people, him being our Father and us being his sons and daughters. See, we haven't contemplated it enough. We haven't prayed over it enough. We haven't walked around saying, God, I want to know this. I want to understand this. I want to have this. Father, you said you'd come and make your dwelling on the inside of me. I've got you, Father, right here, and I want to know that because I don't fully understand it. I don't know how to cooperate with it. Lord Jesus, I got you living right here on the inside of me. I want to understand it so that I can fully cooperate with it. Holy Ghost, I've got you living here on the inside of me. I want to understand it so I can fully cooperate with these things. And dear people, I just want you to know something. God's giving you an opportunity because, I go enough places around the world. I don't get to talk to people like this. I don't get to talk to people like this. I have to talk on such a baby level of you're sweet and wonderful and God loves you and everything's going to be okay. Don't worry about it and let him touch you because he so much wants to touch you. Here, Father's giving you an opportunity. And so many people and there's people in even here that you have so accustomed to listening to the voices of condemnation and shame and fear and torment and intimidation, which are the voices of the demonic, that when you hear things that are challenging, you become overwhelmed with it and feel like a failure. That is the demonic response. That's a demonic response. You're supposed to hear things like this and understand that this is the empowerment of God's word. He's saying, I'm giving you an opportunity. In other words, if you'll grab a hold of it and you'll begin to pursue this, you can have it. I'm giving you an opportunity. I've set an open door before you. And what can I say? The room is filled with all of the riches that go on beyond all the imagination and beyond all that you could ever think or ask. You know, I look at people's, not everybody's written a 30-year plan for me and a 20-year plan, 10-year plan, 5-year plan, 2-year plan, but I can look at your life and tell you what that is. And most people need to go ahead and erase their plans and now first do your 10,000-year plan. And then start, after you've done your 10,000-year plan, then you're going to get your head right. You're going to get your thinking right. And then you're going to start preparing for that 10,000 years. You're going to prepare for that moment that you're about to leave this world and step into the next. And what are you going to have when you get there? Because people are foolish. They pattern themselves after a human realm. And all they're concerned about is a bank account at that moment in time that they're ready to retire. There's far better things to be thinking about. All people are thinking about is how they're going to get through and manage the issues of their bills and their payments and their wants and their wishes and the things they'd like to buy. That is a foolish, blinded life, you see. It will never allow you to be hungry for heaven. See, we got to get all that stuff moved out of the way, that it doesn't have any value or any importance anymore. God has a people that he prepares to seek him. There is a people that is prepared to seek the Lord. There is a people who respond to this love that God pours out to us, pours into us by the Holy Ghost, that then that love causes us to have such a love for him that we don't have any more lovers. We don't have any other relationships, inordinate relationships going on. We don't have anything else. There's nothing else of any value. It all doesn't even matter anymore. Lord, I want to lay hold on you. The Lord tells us in so many different ways, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but reprove them. We don't do that. We just go ahead and have some more fellowship. He tells us to come out from among them, be separate. He tells us that we're not of the world, even as he's not of the world. And the proof of it is that the world hates us just like it hates him. But we don't want to be hated. We want to be liked. And so we accommodate so that we may be liked because we don't want to be hated. But there's a fruit to being not of the world, even as he's not of the world. This is tough stuff. But it's not tough stuff for the people who are hungry, because this is just simply the word of God. I was so blessed. I was so blessed because I got to preach this past weekend to some older preachers. One preacher's 80 years old. His daddy was a preacher, been in Assemblies of God all of his life. And he knew the word of God. I was so blessed. I love preaching to people who know the word of God, because they're going, because I just preach the word of God. And if you know the word of God, you're going, whoa, this is good. I mean, praise God. It's wonderful to have that receptivity. But yet, at the same time, there's only so much things that can be said, because people have got to have their heart prepared to seek God. They've got to have their heart prepared to hear something you're hearing tonight. You're hearing the words of the Holy Ghost. You're hearing things that are right out of the abundance of his grace, that is an opportunity, a door set before you, that if you'll just lay hold on it and say, yes, that's what I want. And okay, I want it so bad, I'm going to change. Because you got to want something desperate to change. It's like the cartoon I saw the other day. How many of you want to change? Everybody raised their hand. How many of you want change? Rather, everybody raised their hand. And how many of you are willing to change? Nobody raised their hand. Everybody wants change, but they're not willing to change. Because that's where the work comes in. The faithfulness in God. But let me just say, I want to read this to you. For God has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness. And I'm going to just tell you, people, you're going to have to deal with that term, because everybody's scared of it. You have to deal with the term righteousness. By that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he has given assurance unto all men, in that he has raised him from the dead. Listen, God has a standard and he will not compromise. I told the Lord one day, I said, Father, all these preachers around me, all these ministers around me tell me I need to make this adjustment and I need to make this change. And if I'll do these things, then I'm going to have more people in the church. And that's supposed to somehow define success to me. And then, of course, it's cloaked by you're going to see more people come into the kingdom. Okay, so I quit preaching the word like I'm preaching it now. More people are going to get saved. That don't make any sense. So I got to change the word of God so that people can accept the word of God. And then that's going to result in salvation. That's not resulting in salvation. But at any rate, I start talking to the Lord about it because, I mean, I'm not going to be hard-headed or stubborn or whatever. I'm going to listen to what people have to say. So I went after and started talking to Father about it. I said, Father, should I just lower the bar a little bit? And the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me so strong. You lower the bar, you got another gospel. You keep it right where it's at. You keep it right where I said it. Father has called you and me to live different kind of lives than many of us have been living. And we've not been willing to. We're going to have to understand that there's a lot of things that got to be cut off and shut off. There's a lot of things that got to be changed. And if we're going to walk in the Holy Ghost and we really want to walk in the Holy Ghost, then when we have a behavior or when we have an action or an attitude that is wrong and inappropriate, we put it to death. That we get that angry. You kill it. And that's what the words are all about. That's what those terminologies are about. Because we know we've been made anew. We know we've been born again. We've got a new heart and a new spirit. We know that we have God the Holy Ghost, God the Father, God the Lord Jesus living on the inside of us. You can't get any cleaner. You can't get any newer. But the attitude and the response to all this war that is going on, this satanic attack against our life to take us in to its power again. We have to recognize how to deal with that. We also have to recognize in the realms of just what we can choose, in the realms of those things that we want for ourselves, the responses and the attitudes that come. I didn't get treated fair. You need to kill that thing. You need to kill it. Slice its both jugular veins on both sides and then take off the back of the spine and hold the head. You need to kill it. You need to kill it. It needs to be put to death. You need to be violent against it. You need to recognize it, that it's the enemy that's going to keep you from being sensitive to the Holy Ghost and walking in that love and walking in that goodness and walking in that humility and walking in that lowliness, which then puts us in a position, a disposition, to be able to receive that which he's supplying. Because we're standing around praying a bunch of doubt and unbelief prayers, asking God to do more. I'm telling you right now, it isn't that way at all. He's asking us to yield. He's asking us to get right. He's asking us to obey. He's asking us to change. He's asking us, quit allowing that stuff that I plainly made clear to you that's not supposed to be in your life. Those attitudes. And it's really there. I mean, I'm telling you right now, there's a great defense and a great protection. If you'll just put on humility, if you'll just walk around in humility, if you'll just put on, be clothed with humility, Peter said. And as Paul said, as dearly beloved children, walk in love. Being clothed with humility and walking in love is a great defense against every wrong attitude and every wrong decision and every wrong behavior. And anybody who thinks that they can do that without the Holy Ghost is absolutely, that's my phrase for arrogant legalism. But what happens is when you become committed, then you know how much you need the Holy Ghost. Now you're at the point of crisis. Now you're there. You're now all of a sudden, John 15:5 becomes valuable to you and you go, my goodness, I get it. I can't do anything without you. I mean, I get it now. I really do get it because I've now finally come to a point that I really, truly, sincerely, I want this kind of life. Hallelujah. Manganda sotori mashaya. Hallelujah. Hapakana seya. Halepana. I pray that you'll want this where you can still walk around. You're not in some hospital, you know, preparing to die. What do they call it? Huh? Convalescing. You know what I'm saying? Papa, take it if you're convalescing. There's not a lot of proof to it. Are you hearing me? I mean, can there be people, and I really even hate to use the word champion. Could it just be people that are willing to be obedient? Could there be obedient children who says, I've got a bad attitude, I'm not having it. I'm putting the thing to death. I've got an offense, I'm not having it. It's going to be put to death. What I've discovered, listen, I've discovered when you walk in peace, you know, so an event happened the other day, and a man of God was saying, asking me, he says, how do you do that? How do you respond that way? I said, well, I just walk in Holy Ghost peace, and when I hear stuff like that or encounter stuff like that, it really doesn't even bother me. It don't go into my heart. It don't go inside me. It don't go into my feelings. It don't go into my emotions. It literally just stays out here, as it were. It never comes, it never seeks inside. Because in here, I'm just overwhelmed with joy. I'm overwhelmed with peace. It's a bakatana moshi yet patai. It is a damote mala, as a maninekeshia, a measure of it. Botana masatea. How deep is a ginish gilama? I hear some people, that's not very deep. La 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 la. That's not very deep. I mean, it's a beginning. That's not very deep. You know what I'm saying? I wouldn't want that much peace. You know, I want some depth to those language. I want diversity. I want some depth to the Holy Ghost praying. You know what I'm saying? I want some depth to love. I want some depth to joy. I want some depth to peace. I want some depth to goodness. Woo! Yeah. Man, when you walk in goodness, you are happy with everybody. When you walk in goodness, you're like, woo, this is great. You could be walking around in sackcloth, you know, in a prison going, woo, this is so good. Goodness creates for us something on the inside that nothing on the outside can in any way mitigate. Nothing on the outside could ever do it to be in the first place, and nothing on the outside can in any way intimidate it, stop it, hurt, change it. Because it's something from the inside. It's a river flowing. I mean, you know, if we just stopped and said and measured, so I have rivers of God's quality and kind of life coming out of me, most people would have to say no. I think that it would be a definition of revival if God's people had enough that would be coming out of a garden hose coming out of them on a continual basis. I believe that would be a revival. I believe that would be a new threshold. If it was just a garden hose level of the glory and life and majesty and nature and character and disposition of God Almighty continually flowing. Just a garden hose. Father looks to us and says, how long are we willing to go without any flow? He sees it. He's right in the big middle. There's nothing hidden from him. We naked before him. Huh? The word of God is living and it's powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It divides asunder joint from marrow, soul from spirit. Is a thought, a discerner of the thought and the intent of our hearts. For we are naked before him. And nothing is hidden. His word goes forth right now and he tries us. His word right now makes you naked. His word now right now reveals. People ask me, well, I'm thinking about this guy or this girl. I said, bring them to church. Man, I'll tell you what they are. Just get them in the meeting. Well, can't you just walk up to them? No, not like in the church, because the word goes forth by the Holy Ghost in a unique way in the church. And everything is manifested. Everything is revealed. It's just the way it is. And I like it. Let your light shine. Let your floodlight shine. I don't want his floodlight to shine on me, and then I'm not willing to change. I'm not willing to do anything about it. I'm willing to continue to go on. I'm not the same person I was last year. And I'm not going to be the same person next year that I am now. I'm going to grow and I'm going to mature. And I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to come to vision and I'm going to come to revelation. And I'm going to come into a greater depth of miracles and signs and wonders, because I have set my heart to seek the Lord. I've set my heart to seek the Lord. In other words, when I see and identify things in my life that are wrong, it's going to die. I'm putting it to death. I hear people say, you know, our preacher the other day said, he said to me, he said, oh, that person you saw last year is dead. I said, no, you're still alive. He's still alive. You just more mature. Because we got the battle on the wrong ground. We got the battle on the wrong ground. It's these things that we're allowing to influence us that needs to die. It's the things that we are allowing to continue to mess with our attitudes in the realms of the satanic to hinder us from the things that God has for us, because he sets up a barricade. He sets up, builds a wall, as it were, between us and that which Father is supplying. And you and I got to be willing to recognize it for what it is and destroy it. That's putting to death everything that is contrary to the will of God. That is truly the mortifying, putting into place, the proper place, your members which are upon this earth. And my members are the members of God. And he's saying, you can't have your members over here in your self-interest. You can't hold bad attitudes and wrong thinking and wrong behavior. I've asked the Lord, I said, Father, I see simple-minded people who never get it. They never obey. They never listen. They won't pay attention in church. They will continue to violate things. Do you just leave them alone? Or do we get them healed? And the Spirit of the Lord says, and nobody's simple-minded ever going to get healed until they recognize that it's simple-minded and they want to get healed. Simple-minded can't remember. You know what I'm saying? Simple-minded doesn't cooperate. They're not really rebellious. They're just simple-minded. They're simple-minded. They don't get it. They're like a child with, you know, what everybody says is ADD, but they're just constantly distracted. Huh? My interest is for everyone, not just for a couple of you. I'm looking at every one of you. I'm looking at every single one of you. I see every single person at this building here tonight. And I'm not looking at any person going, you know what, they really don't qualify. Because that's just not the truth. But you know what I do see? You know what I do see? I do see people who disqualify themselves. And I want you not to disqualify yourself anymore. And people disqualify themselves for a whole bunch of different reasons. Because they just got to do this or they got to do that. She's a major distraction, I know. But this is helping her. Hallelujah. I was so blessed today to have both of my sons preaching. One in Oregon, one here in San Diego. Have all my kids ministering. You did 3 to 5s today, you know. And then that's what it's all about. I'm gonna set my heart, my grandchildren to do the same thing. We're going to raise up a godly seed. What we're going to do is we're going to go after this thing. Let me tell you right now, so many people just, they don't even care. They're more interested in the grandbabies. They're more interested in the dog food. Make sure we got dog food for the dog. Then how they're going to apply themselves to stepping into that which God demands of us. God demands of us growth and maturity in the Holy Ghost so that the life of Jesus can be seen. God demands the anointing. The anointing teaches us everything, teaches us fundamentally how to abide in him. What's going to happen when we abide in him? Then these works are going to happen in our life. There's going to be a growth and a maturity in the things of the Spirit so that those things which Father demands to have in our life, the manifestation of the Holy Ghost, of signs and wonders, of prophecy, of tongues, of interpretation of tongues, they're going to be in our life. You know, we're not going to be people that are known for running our children and our household constantly to the doctors and the lawyers and to the financial planners. We're going to be people that are known to walk in divine health, to walk in divine provision, hallelujah, to walk in the Holy Ghost, hallelujah. Take us, Sutananaya. Miss? Mandoko Shia Namaha. Mandoko Shia Namaha. Lea Tasu. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Mighty God. It's just not right to ignore Father. It's not right to be involved in something else while God's talking like this. It's a dishonor of him. I don't care what it is. It's dishonoring him. That didn't happen 60 years ago in the church. It didn't happen 100 years ago in the church. There was a sacredness. There was an honor. Thus, when the Holy Ghost began to move, people went somewhere with it. So we have a move of the Spirit now. People, they have no concept of the sacred. They have no concept of that which is right and wrong.
They don't go anywhere with it.
It here's the move of God poured out, and it really doesn't, you know, it should have, let's just kind of put it at a distance. It should have taken us around the world, and we didn't get around the block with it. Are you listening to me? Well, if you would begin to say, wait a minute, okay, Father's got something going on here. There's a move of God. And you say, there's a move of God coming. There's a great move of God coming. I have a continual move of God in my life, but there are sovereign moves of God. There's a great move of God coming. I want to be prepared for it. I want to be ready. And you like, you get this Evan Roberts attitude. What do I got to do to be a part of it? What do I got to do to be in one of those revivals? And then suddenly you hear someone say, you need to seek God. You need to start letting every part of your life be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ and quit playing games with God. Quit playing. You can't just say yes and not do it. Because if you say yes, Father sees you saying yes and will watch you tomorrow as you don't do it. And that is serious in trouble. It's better to say, no, I'm not going to do it and go. I'm almost going to look at that as the millennials. You know what I'm saying? Are you with me?
Yes.
Some of you know what I mean, right? The millennials, they're in power. They're going to say, no, I'm not doing nothing, right? Whatever you want them to do, they're not going to do it, right? But then they go ahead and do it. I want you to understand that this is, you can quantitate what I'm talking about. You can quantitate it by the way that you say, I'm no longer going to pray my little mealy mouth prayers. I'm going to start until I step over into a realm in the Holy Ghost where the atmosphere of my life begins to change. Because if there's anything that's going on, people don't know how to receive from the Holy Spirit. And not knowing how to receive from the Holy Spirit and hook up with Him, you're never going to do any of this. You're never going to do it. Most people have never even wanted to do it desperately enough to even come to reality and conscious awareness that they can't do it because they never tried. They just play pretend in their mind that they're doing it. Are you listening to me? Because some of it's simple-mindedness. And some of it is neglect. And some of it is just, some of it's stubbornness. But I want you to get serious with God. I want you to let those things that, excuse me, Christ Jesus identified as being in the way. I want you to identify Him as being in the way. You haven't identified seeking for your own food and your own clothing as being in the way yet. But He said it's in the way. You haven't identified your attitudes as being in the way yet. But He says it's in the way. You haven't identified the fact that you're not willing to go to prayer. I think you ought to make that book available to everybody, baby. Go buy a couple of copies of Contact with God, because Jenny Wilkerson shows you're not going to have any contact with God until you learn how to pray. And prayer is not something that you're going to, prayer is not something you're going to normally have. You're going to have to work for it and labor and get into it. Have any of you ever seen Jenny Wilkerson minister? Any of you? She used to minister with Kenneth Hagin. Because when Ken Hagin first started his ministry, really, all the Assemblies of God, everybody had an anointing in the Assemblies of God kind of gathered around it. I mean, it was the raw thing early on in it, the real thing, the raw thing. So she's there ministering, Clara Grace. Anybody heard Clara? Grace. Just, you guys ought to listen to these. You ought to go back and listen to the richness of the Spirit, the people had developed in their life from walking with God back in the 40s and the 50s. Because you got to go back that far. By and large, you got to go back that far. Because everybody's just sitting around doing something that they've modeled after other people. Wrong models. There's a realm, and Father's calling you into it, and you got to be willing to come. And I really encourage people, if you can't see it, if you can't get it, go back and look at people behind. Go back and see models in the past. Go back and read the books of the past in the former days.
I mean, I still do to this day, and books that I've already read before, and I'm still moved to the same kind of passion after I'm finished reading. Man, I need to learn how to pray, because there's so much of it's right around prayer. And you know, over and again, it's been said, little prayer, little power. Little prayer, little faith. Little faith, little power. And then there was something that people even hate to hear even more. Little fasting, little prayer. Well, I don't have time for that. Well, I just want you to understand, people, it's not legalism. It's not earning anything with God. It's being hungry. It's just a response of being hungry. And Father's not going to move until we're hungry. It's just the way it is. He demands hunger. He demands thirsting. He demands diligence. He says it over and over and over again. He says, when you're like a person that's in the desert, whose tongue is swollen up in your mouth, your tongue cleaves to your mouth now. You with me? It's like it's being integrated with the roof of your, the tissue of your tongue is being integrated with the tissue of the roof of your mouth. That's how thirsty you are. He said, then, you that thirsty? I'll open heaven and pour out glory upon you. Why does it need to be that way? Because what he has is so sacred. The things that he's described for us to live in and have and respond to and walk in is ever bit as sacred as it was when it was the holies of holies, the tabernacle in the wilderness. It's nothing's changed. We've made it common because we've never really understood the beauty of it. Well, if we would have recognized, now through the passion, I want more of this, then what God would have been able to do is tell us and teach us personally how sacred it is. And then we would have gotten hungry and responsive within the sacred to begin to value the sacred. And then we would now be able to receive what he wants to give, because it's sacred. He's not going to mix it up or allow mix it up with that which is unsacred, nor allow us to pollute ourselves and pollute his realm of glory. He's waiting for us. You're not waiting for him. He's waiting for you. He's waiting for you to deal with your attitudes. He's waiting for you to deal with the priorities of your life. He's waiting for you to be so desperate and earnest about conforming to the image and walking in the Holy Ghost that now you don't allow anything other than that. You don't allow in your life things that don't perfectly match. And I hesitate to use that word, because it's better than perfectly match. It's unified with the image. Hello. Hallelujah. Father's got this for you. If you look to yourself, you're going to get all discouraged and upset and bummed out, worried and weird. But if you say, wow, this is what Father wants for me, well, He's sovereign Lord. He says, I'm El Shaddai, which means absolute sovereignty. Another way it's said is, I'm Almighty God. That means the absolute sovereign one, El Shaddai. It doesn't mean more than enough. It means absolute sovereign, Almighty God. So that's why he uses it. That's why he puts it right there at the end of the phrase in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. Walk before me, he says, come out from among them. Be separate. Touch not the unclean thing. I shall receive you. And I shall be your father, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Because I'm going to empower you. He's waiting for someone to respond. It's like the miracle of the new birth. He's waiting for somebody to say, I want that. The miracle comes. He's waiting for us to say, I want that. The miracle's there available. Now, he's empowered us. He's given us enough power and enough ability to deal with the issues, to say no to temptation, to deal with attitudes, anything that's not conformed to the image, anything that's out of sorts. But what do? Many times, and especially people, listen to me, if you're not touching heaven when you get up in the morning, you're not touching heaven when you get up in the morning. If you're not willing to reach out into that realm of heaven, set that appointment with the Lord and keep it every day. I'll tell you right now, I pray throughout the day. I probably could be, I'm very close to praying without continually praying. I'm very close to it. I don't continually pray, but I'm close to it. I'll get a stiffy effort of my mustatala to mama out about every 10 minutes. You know what I'm saying? At least. But I still have my hour of prayer at 7 o'clock at night. I still have my time of prayer where I'm going to go into another realm. I'm going to touch heaven. I'm shutting everything out. I'm not multitasking. I'm shutting everything out, and I'm touching heaven. People, I'm going to tell you right now, some of you need to come and do this with me because I think you're getting a different result that I'm talking about. Because if you're satisfied with what you're getting a different, your goal is wrong. Huh? It will change the way you pray, the way your tongue, it will change the sound of the tongues that comes out of your mouth. It will change the influence of the anointing in your life. The anointing is nothing more than the life and power of Christ Jesus being revealed through us. And the greater anointing is a greater display of the life and power of Jesus. That's what that is. That's what we want. I like people to be very detailed and specific so they're going after the right thing here, okay? Not some feeling. Well, I feel something. Well, good. Praise God. Now let's go after the life and power of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. And see, I believe that there's every person sitting in this place. I believe to some degree you want these things. There's a vast majority of you that are prepared and you're ready to move forward. I believe that some of you who want these things that are not really prepared to move forward, there's a number of issues that you're going to have to deal with, and I want you to deal with them tonight. I'm getting ready to close. Some of them is that you've got a wrong idea of where you're going. You've lowered the bar. And thus you don't enter into the realm. If I was satisfied with the expression of the Holy Ghost coming through my life, I would have lowered the bar. But I am so desperate and so hungry, I esteem it, what I'm talking to you about, more important than my necessary food. Are you with me? Yeah. You decide what you want tonight in God. And decide whether or not you want what He's described. Because if you're going to settle for something less than He's described, He's coming to judge the world in righteousness. And I'm not sure how you affair to have lowered the bar in your heart. I don't. I believe it's too sacred. I believe that Father's too passionate about it for us to go and pick and choose what we want or to go some part way and not go all the way. We have to be willing. We have to be willing. And this is it. And I want to simplify this for you as much as I can. We have to be willing, first of all, to let Father have His way fully in our lives. We have to be willing. And then we've got to get so hungry for it to be that way that we quit acting like it's all God's fault, that we're not that way. And recognize that He's placed it within us and upon us to rise up and deal with the issue. Let me give you, I'm just going to give you one verse of scripture, highlight verse of scripture. I can give you so many on this. But when He tells us this, that we can know the love of Christ that passes knowledge and by it be filled with all the fullness of God, which is, that's everything. That's the rivers. He tells us that it is that will happen because of the power that is at work in us. That's going to happen because He's empowered us. He's put a treasure in these earthen vessels that the excellency of the glory and the power may be of Him. That's His empowerment. That's all sovereign Lord. That's absolute sovereign God giving us the ability now to do what He's told us to do, and He wants us to walk in perfect obedience. But He's now put the perfect, He put it more specific, the kind of perfect obedience He wants us to have. Be conformed to the image of the Son. Don't be conformed to this world. And we've got to understand it. We've got to understand the absolute definition of worldliness. Can I give you the absolute definition of worldliness? Jesus is not worldliness. Everything else is. Jesus is the otherness. He pressed himself against all the world. He said, I am not of the world. That had already been defined previously by holiness. That's what defines God. He's holy because he is distinctly different from everything else, including angels. They scream, holy, 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 as they cover their face. He says, we can come and gaze. He anointed Aaron, but he wouldn't allow Aaron to gaze. Filled the place up with incense. He allowed Moses to gaze. He only allowed Moses to gaze. But look at the progression. He says to Moses, when Moses first encounters him, he says, do not come near me. Those are the exact words he used. Do not come near me. Take off your shoes, you're on holy ground. But what happens with Moses? In obedience to God, he goes, risk everything. In obedience to God, he lays down his life for a bunch of murmuring and complaining people. Are you with me? And in that midst of this, he's just so hungry for God. He's so hungry. He's like, I'll do anything for you. I mean, his carrot, if you would, was the Lord said, if you'll do what I say, and the proof that I have sent you, and the evidence that I have sent you, and the evidence of who I am will be displayed to you because I will allow you to come back here and worship me. We have something greater than Mount Sinai. Nobody understands it. No one understands it. If we understood it, we would run to it and would run in there and would have access to it. We've not understood it enough to understand the entrance in. But tonight that can change. And I'm telling you right now, I'm talking to you now about being able to have the life you'd like to die to and go to. About having the life that you would like to die and go to, rather. Because you can live a heavenly life right now. You can live in the realms of the glory right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want everybody to stand with me. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Paprobosokoya. You know, when the psalmist said, put a watch on my mouth and keep the door of my lips, he was responding to an empowerment that God would give. I say this to you. I could easily say to you, some of you tonight, you don't get it. And if I could say to you, you don't get it in a way to where that it would result in you saying, teach me, then I would tell you. God would show you. I mean, I'm actually talking in the first person of the Lord. I'm not saying me. I'm prophesying. I'm just telling you. I would tell you. I just didn't put saith the Lord there. Somebody says, well, where does it start? It starts because he sees you obediently saying, okay, I'm not going to be conformed to this world. I am going to be conformed to Christ Jesus. Holy Ghost, I'm desperate. I'm desperate. I want to get this right. I'm desperate. I'm desperate. And then he sees that it's more than just a one-week fad. He sees you start taking the mat with prayer because you got it now. Hit it while it's hot. You got it now. Hit it while it's hot. So now I've got prayer time. I've got that prayer time. I'm in the Word. I'm understanding this. Father, I want this. I don't want to let this slip. I don't want to let this slip because the Lord says, if you neglect so great a salvation, this is what he said, you will definitely perish. I don't want to let it slip. Hold fast to it. Unless at any time you let it slip, I don't want to let it slip. I don't want to let it slip. I want to get this, Father. I want to get this. I want to understand how to do this. I thank you, Lord, for your loving kindness. And see, it's still in the context of thanksgiving. It's still in context of praise. Still in context of faith. But it's us dealing with ourself. Because the cross is where you say, I no longer have an option to do anything other than the will of the Father. I've willed the will of the Father, that means I don't have a will anymore. I have personally said, Father's not taking my will away. I am. You are. That's presenting our bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. That's tying, binding ourselves to the horn of the altar so we don't move. That's what I'm talking about, right? We don't move. And we don't move when? At the moment in times where we're ready to, you know, do our own thing, make our own choices. Thank you, Father, for the anointing that takes your word where it's supposed to go. Thank you, Father, for the willingness of every person in this place to do it your way, to say, okay, I'm going to learn how to conform to the image of Christ Jesus in every way. I'm going to quit having my own way and calling it God's way. I'm going to quit playing pretend. I'm going to quit saying it's just too tired and I don't have enough time. And I'm going to recognize that there was something terribly wrong with that statement. I'm too tired and don't have enough time. There's something terribly wrong with that statement. And God's not going to come down and sort it out and correct it. You got to sort it out. You got to be earnest enough and hungry enough that you sort it out and correct it. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you right now. God is going to pour out heaven upon this place. You know why? And this is the grace of God. This is the grace of God. Because of one man's sin. One man's sin. God's army lost the war. Because of one man's sin, God's army was defeated. Achan. Are you with me? That's the way God feels about it. Can you hear me? That's the way God feels about it. My attitudes, my realm of thinking is based upon what God said in His Word. I know who He is. He doesn't change. And you can know who He is because you can read His Word too. But when you read His Word to do it, and you read His Word to be conformed to Him, to obey Him, to know Him, because you're desperate, suddenly His Word becomes a new book. But God in His mercy will not even allow that right now. I've said, Lord, does it really take 100% of a church to begin to move into this, into obedience to You for the body, the person of Jesus to be revealed? And in many ways, that's the way I've understood it. And of course, think about that. Think about me understanding it that way and then how desperate I am because I want to see that connectivity. I want to see that result. I want to see the fullness of Him that filleth all things being revealed. And you go to sorting that out. Come on, get right, get right, get right. And people just pull back on you. Well, I'm convinced in my spirit that the Father will take. He doesn't want to. I'm going to preface what I'm going to say with that. But He will take the church that is here and everybody that is desperate and everybody that is hungry, and He will utilize that. Amen. He will utilize that. Can you imagine? But think about this, and this is why I hate this. The concept of having the body of Christ within the church. Can you hear what I just said? That the whole church isn't the body of Christ, the body of Christ is within the church. I've not been willing to accept that because I've not been willing as a pastor to leave anyone out. But when it comes to a place that I come to understand, I didn't leave them out. They chose to be left out. Because that's Father's heart. Father said, I didn't leave them out. They chose to be left. They chose not to listen. They chose not to comply. They chose not to go with me. So I pray tonight in the name of Jesus, every one of you choose, go with Him. Just don't be left out.
Don't be left out. Don't be left out. If you need a miracle tonight, the miracle is here. I'm going to just help you understand. You don't have to convince God to give the miracle. The miracle's in the house. You have to receive the miracle. Somebody says, why can't I receive the miracle? Because you need to learn how to yield to the Holy Ghost. And that really, a lot of that comes right down to the place where you've been living and the challenges that you go through. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost upon your daughter. Thank you, Jesus. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Father, I thank you for the people who stand up and take the brunt of it and are willing to fight the good fight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Tonight, I want you to grab a hold of that there is no condemnation. There's no shame. There's no fear. There is a call. There is a call. And you need to deal with whether or not you are choosing to be left out. You need to deal with it. You need to deal with how passionate you are to be baptized in the Holy Ghost with the expression thereunto. You need to deal with it. You know what I'm desperate to have? I'm desperate to have flowing out of my life rivers of divine expression. I'm desperate. I'm going to have it.
Me too.
I'm going to lay hold on it.
Yes.
I'm not going to play pretend. Huh? Amen. I'm going to have rivers. Prakotana. Yes. I'm going to have, we're going to step into a place in God where we will walk in to the grocery store to get a piece of bread and the rivers knock people down under the power of God. There's just too many people that got into it. There's no reason for us to be constantly being held at bay by the Antichrist spirit. Amen. Because the Antichrist spirit's bigger than what the anointing we know how to move in. Bigger than the life of Christ that we know how to function in. We're going to do this. Geneva, we're going to do this. Put your hands towards heaven. Makeshitaya. Thank you, Jesus. Mande prisato nekeshti. You have what you have because you're the first one up here in your heart. She just says there she is in her heart. You hear me? It's the altar. Prepare your heart to seek God. Just prepare your heart to seek God. I break this thing off of you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I command your body to work properly. Really, what you've gone through is just, literally, it is an attack of Satan against the body of Christ. And it's hit your body. And that's just the way it happens. The people that are standing there, right along with Christ Jesus, many times go through these kinds of things. In Jesus' name, I command you to be healed, strengthened in your body. Be strengthened in your body right now. Huh. Huh. Ha, prasatast. Menastake. Strengthen in your body right now. Now, from the crown of your head, so does your feet. Jesus. Jesus. Manastate. Kieste tenemus. Morastate. And Jesus. Now, Jesus. From the crown of your head, so does your feet. Stuart, the Lord wants to make you hungry.
Yes.
He wants to make you hungry.
Yes.
He wants to make you hungry. Let him. Let him make you hungry.
Thank you.
You want me to tell you how he makes you hungry?
Yes.
You start doing exactly what he said to do. And you don't have anything else. Just that way. Because you can pray all day. If you don't obey, it doesn't do nothing. You're going to have to obey. So just do it. Just do it. Just do it. Just do the works of Jesus. Just do the works of Jesus. Do the works of Jesus. Do the works of Jesus and let the river flow. Just do the works of Jesus. Let the river flow. Just do the works of Jesus.